question when I think about the state of the United Methodist Church today. Has God left the building? Has God left the United Methodist Church? Or another question, has the United Methodist Church accepted God's protection, God's provision, but have we left God's presence? Are we living into the fears of our great founder, John Wesley? For he said, I am not afraid that the people called Methodists should ever cease to exist, either in Europe or America. But I am afraid lest they should only exist as a dead sect, having a form of religion without power. And this undoubtedly will be the case unless they hold fast both to doctrine, spirit, and discipline with which they first set out. Are we living into this? Have we stepped out of the presence of God? Have we depended upon his presence, his P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, his gifts? Have we depended upon his protection? Have we depended upon his provision? But have we moved forward without his presence? For it's in his presence that God loves, dwells. We should love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, but yet we should also love our neighbor as ourselves. But have we stepped out of the presence of God? Have we segregated ourselves on each Sunday, having a black church or white church or Korean church or Native American church? Have we segregated ourselves in socioeconomic classes? Do we have the affluent over here and the poor over here? Do we have the ones with degrees over here? And do we have the ones with no high school diploma over here? And now we're here in an issue facing our way forward. Well, now we have to make a decision upon human sexuality, issue that has been just bombarding our meetings and annual and general conference. Do we love our brother and sister no matter what their sexual preference is? Or do we shun them away? Do we turn our back? Do we, as the United Church, divide ourselves? What should we do? Should we stand in with God? Should we rest in his presence? Or have we continued to move forward without his presence? Have we opened up all these edifices in each community, opening up the doors and stand up in the pulpits with our religious rhetoric, but with no God? Are we singing songs of worship, but there is no God's presence in our worship? Have we, as a United Methodist Church, moved forward without God's presence? You see, I don't know the future of our denomination, but here is one thing I do know. As Moses shows us here in verse 7, that we should dare to move forward without God's presence. You see, Moses shows us that Moses began to pitch a tent. And not only did he pitch a tent, but he took his tent away from the camp. And he had a meeting with God. Now, my mother would say that he went into his prayer closet. My grandmother would say that he went into his war room. That he began to pray, and I don't know what it looked like. Did he lay upon his face? Did he bow on his knees? Did he hold up his hands? Did he close his eyes? Did he cry? I have no idea. But one thing I do know is that Moses began to pray. His heart began to reach out to God's heart, and God's heart began to respond to man's heart. That's prayer. That's when the relationship with God really builds. When you're able to confront God. You see, Moses didn't go in. He was humble, but yet bold. And I think it's those times when we wrestle with the word of God is when we really find and understand our faith. You see, God said, take your people. Moses said, no, they are your people. God says, you have to move from this place. Moses said, oh, but not without you. Moses, I think, is practicing what James 5 tells us. He says, the effectual, fervent prayers of the righteous man availeth much. He was fervent with his prayer. He was honest with his prayer. He was open to God. He said, God, show me your way so that I may know you. I want a deeper relationship with you, God. Lord, I want your presence. We can't move forward without your presence. And Moses petitioned God, and God's response was, I've heard your cry, and I will go forward with you. I know the Lord, he heard my cry. And as we are here today and we've gathered here in concert and we've praised God, we've worshiped God, and we've brought our insecurities in here to God, and we are wondering, what are we going to do as a church body locally, but what are we going to do as a denomination? I believe, in fact, I know, that we stand upon giants, that the prayers of our mothers and the prayers of our fathers are still moving forward to this day. And I think when Moses petitioned in the tent, that he asked God, he said, God, show me your way. And I believe that God not only showed him his way, but it was a setup for God to send the way. And they called him Jesus. He was not only the way, but he was truth and life. And Jesus said, when we come together, there he will be in the midst. His presence will be with us. If we praise and worship him and follow his lead, he will lead us into the presence of God. It is through Jesus that we have our protection. It is through Jesus that we have our provision. It is through Jesus that we have total access to God's presence. It is when we pray. It is when we humble ourselves, get down on our knees, and pray unto the Almighty God is when he shows up and his presence dwells with us. You see, I tell you this not because of something I read, but I tell you this because of something I know. You see, just like the Israelites, they were in a distressed state. They were in a place of anxiety. They were in this place of not knowing. I recall several years ago, as I began this journey to become a local pastor, and it was a struggle at first. I got lost in the system several times, but when I finally found my way on the right track and everything seems to have been going well, then I find out that my wife was pregnant. And now I'm on the track to become a local pastor. Now I have a pregnant wife, and now I have a full-time job, and I'm also the youth minister of the We Are One. And I had my family pulling, and I felt like I had the weight of the world on me. And I didn't know what to do or how to go forward. And I remember opening my mouth to pray to God, but I could not articulate the feelings and the emotions that I had inside me. I had no idea what to say. But I recall what my mother told me years ago. She said, son, if you don't have the words to say, just remember this one word she said, just call on his name, Jesus. And I remember calling on the name of Jesus. And it was with Jesus that he reminded me, son, that I am your peace. That, son, that I am your joy. That it's in me that you are more than a conqueror, that you can do anything in Christ Jesus. And I got so engulfed in this conversation, I began to walk out my house and I placed my things in my car. And I got in my car and I began to drive. And I went miles and miles away from my home and was on the highway. And on this highway, there was a stoplight. And I remember stopping at the stoplight. And I was continuing my conversation with God, petitioning his throne, and I heard a horn blow. And it was the guy in the truck next to me, and he said, sir, I'm not sure if you're aware, but there's something on your trunk. And I looked back in my rearview mirror, and I saw that the iPad that I carried out the house, that my charger that I carried out the house, that I didn't put it in the inside of my car. That I had sat it upon the trunk, and when I got out and looked upon the trunk, my iPad and my charger was in one place. Now, I must admit that although I'm a pastor, that I do speed, that there's no limit in my car, that I turn curves pretty hard. And it was at that moment that I had what we Methodists call an altar gates moment. It was at that moment that when I sat back in my car, tears started to roll down my eyes, that I felt God's presence. I felt my heart strangely warm. And I remember clearly God saying, my presence will go with you. And I believe that as we are here and we petition his throne, that not like Elvis, who has left the building, that God will stay. And if we decide to move forward and we pray and we cry out to him, he will hear our cry and he will respond with his presence. Has God left the building? No. As long as there are people that loves him and that humbles themselves and that will cry out to him, he will not leave the building. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, God, just for another opportunity to experience your presence. God, may we not be like the stiff-necked people. God, help us to humble ourselves, for sometimes we know that we can be. So help us humble ourselves, God, and help us to call out to you and admit our faults. Help us to call out to you, God, from your presence. Help us to be with you, in you and us. It is in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Let us stand.